This is your one chance to just dance. Yeah. Come on, let the beat put you in the trance and just dance. South Dakota to the south of France. Yeah, huh. See, I wanna rock right now. Stepped up in the spot to get down. I am internationally known for acting classy, trashy, and grown. Let's get stupid, outrageous. You can't fake this, it's contagious. Just move it, don't stay stiff. It's a rhythm that you can't play with. It's the groove that I selected. It's infectious, all you affected need to get on the flow.
Okay, welcome to lesson 4, and the topic of this lesson is linguistic anthropology and archaeology. If you recall, we started out by talking about the general field of cultural anthropology, and we said that there were three large subfields within cultural anthropology. And the last lesson, we looked at the first one, which was ethnology. And in this lesson, we're going to look at the other two, linguistic anthropology and archaeology. And we're going to start by asking ourselves some questions. And the first question is, in general, what is linguistic anthropology? And the second question, because linguistic anthropology also has subfields. So what are the subfields of linguistic anthropology? And the second half of this lesson is archaeology. So we will ask ourselves the question, what is archaeology? And lastly, archaeology also has some subfields in it. So the fourth question is going to be, what are the subfields of archaeology? So that's the gist of this lesson. So let's begin with the first question, which was, what is linguistic anthropology?
Darmok and Gilad at Tanagra. Our situation is similar to theirs. I understand that, but I need to know more. You must tell me more about Darmok and Jalad. Tell me. You used the words Temba, his arms wide, when you gave me the knife and the fire. Could that mean give? Temba, his arms wide. Darmok. Give me more about Darmok.
Darmok on the ocean.
Darmok. Darmok. The ocean. Darmok on the ocean. A metaphor. Being alone, isolated. Darmok on the ocean.
Tanagra.
At Tanagra. Country?
stronger on the ocean, an island. Temba, his arms wide.
Jalad on the ocean. Jalad at Tanagra.
Jalad at Tanagra. He went to the same island as Darmok. Darmok and Jalad at Tanagra.
The beast at Tanagra.
The beast? There was a creature at Tanagra. Darmok and Jalad, the beast of Tanagra. They arrived separately. They struggled together against a common foe, the beast at Tanagra. Darmok and Jalad at Tanagra.
Darmok and Jalad on the ocean.
They left together. Darmok and Jalad on the ocean.
The ocean. Send up! It's beast! It's on
anyway. This is a story, a very ancient one, from Earth. I try and remember it. Gilgamesh, a king. Gilgamesh, a king at Uruk. He tormented his subjects. He made them angry. They cried out aloud, "Send us a companion for our king. Spare us from his madness." Enkidu, a wild man from the forest, entered the city. They fought in the temple. They fought in the streets. Gilgamesh defeated Enkidu. They became great friends. Gilgamesh and Enkidu at Uruk. The new friends went out into the desert together, where the great bull of heaven was killing men by the hundreds. Enkidu caught the bull by the tail. Gilgamesh struck him with his sword.
Gilgamesh.
They were victorious. But Enkidu fell to the ground, struck down by the gods. And Gilgamesh wept bitter tears, saying, "He who was my companion through adventure and hardship is gone forever."
Okay, so what exactly is linguistic anthropology? So let's talk about some of its meanings. So in general, it is the study of human speech and language. In fact, language is so important. Language in humans is so important that there is a separate branch of anthropology to study it, and that is linguistic anthropology. So let's take a look at language specifically. If we're going to talk about the fact that linguistic anthropology is the study of language, then what exactly is language? So language is a sophisticated communication system that includes vocabulary, also known as lexicon, and a set of rules, also known as grammar, which outlines its proper use. So every language that we have today is a sophisticated communication system, and within every language there is a lexicon or a vocabulary, and there is a specific set of rules or grammar that outlines exactly how that language is to be used properly. And there are three main areas within linguistic anthropology that linguistic anthropologists study. And the first one is they study the structure of language. And so there are a couple things within the structure of language that they look at specifically. The first one is they look at the development of the physical structures in humans, such as the brain and the larynx, which is also known as our voice box, that make sophisticated speech possible. If you look at the picture on the left, you'll see a map that has our brain and our larynx and other parts that are all important in how humans develop speech. And when you look at other organisms, they don't have these sophisticated structures, and therefore other organisms don't have the ability for sophisticated speech. So that is one thing that linguistic anthropologists look at. The second thing that they look at is they look at the rules. They look at the development of these sophisticated rules. Right, they look at the development of sophisticated rules of grammatical structure of a language. And the third thing they look at is how people, and in particular infants, acquire language. How do we acquire language? very important how infants can acquire language. All right, so that's the first main area that linguistic anthropologists study. The second main area that they study is the origins of language. Where does language come from? So they ask themselves a number of questions. So where do different languages come from? That picture on the left is the Tower of Babel, which is a biblical story about how different languages came about. So that's one thing that they look at with respect to the origins of language. The second question they ask themselves is, how did languages develop? How did we get to the stage in human development where we have sophisticated language? Arguably, when you look back at our ancestors, they didn't have sophisticated language. At some point it began to develop, and that's what they look at. And thirdly, they look at how our languages are related historically. Meaning, today we have lots of very different languages, but at some point they may all have come from one root language. So they are families of languages that are related, and they want to look at the historical path that perhaps led from one root language to lots of different languages that we have today. So that is the second main area that linguistic anthropologists study, that being the origins of language. And the third main area that they look at is the relationship between language and culture. So they ask themselves how language affects how people in a particular culture perceive things. Different cultures perceive things differently, and language plays a part in how we perceive things. As an example, in English, in southern Canada, we generally have one word for snow. We perceive snow as a simple form of precipitation. But up in the Arctic, the Inuit, they have dozens of different words for snow, because in their culture, snow plays a significant part. And so they have a number of different words for the different kinds of snow that they experience. And so their language, their number of different words for snow, impacts their culture and how they perceive snow. So that would be an example. And the other thing that they tend to look at in terms of language and culture is something that we see every day around us, and that is dialects and slang. So different cultures have different dialects, which could include different accents, and obviously cultures have their own slang, and these things are impacted by class and gender and geography. You look at all of these factors. So working class versus upper class might have different levels of education, and so they might use language differently. And how women and men use language might be very different. And also geography plays a significant part in developing dialects, let's say. Okay, so that is the third main area that linguistic anthropologists study. They study the structure of language, they study the origin of language, and they study how language and culture develop and impact each other. All right, the second main question of this lesson are, what are the subfields of linguistic anthropology? So we are going to look at three of them. The first one is historical linguistics.
To convey information.
Language is a biological tool that is only available to the human species, and that enables the species to communicate.
Language is a mental construct with a set of rules and organizing principles, and as linguists we're interested in finding out what those are.
Modern human language is quite a sophisticated thing. And how did it spring up? In some sense it must have been an invention.
There were many people around on Earth 100,000 years ago, but we all come from a very small group, maybe a few thousand people, who were somewhere in East Africa. The reason why they developed more than the rest and spread the whole world is that they had developed a better language.
When you're talking about the origin of language, are you talking about the origin of the language faculty being able to speak, or are you talking about the origin of those languages that now exist on the planet? We believe that all of the languages that now exist on Earth only go back about 50,000 years. The languages that now exist have been very recent, and all of the earlier languages have been erased. They've been lost. Those languages no longer exist, and there's no trace of them as well.
I suspect that the first utterances consisted of things that were transitional between calls and words.
Genetically, there's increasing evidence that the Khoisan people are the oldest people.
There's a great deal of argument about why the click sounds can be found only in one location. Some people claim that it's the oldest sound in the world and it remains from the original languages. There's really absolutely no evidence that that's true, and we just don't know.
Okay, so what exactly does historical linguistics look at? So they look at similarities and differences of languages so that they can understand how languages are related. And as a result, how populations migrated in the past. If you look at different languages, how they're related, they might lead back to a particular root language, and that would suggest that people of different parts of the world may or may not have at one point lived together, and then they migrated into different areas, and as a result, different languages developed. So one specific example that we can look at is the research of Edward Sapir. Edward Sapir was an American anthropologist who for a period of time worked in Canada, and what he did is he studied Canada's various Aboriginal languages. He looked at their similarities and differences, and he tried to understand how they were related And then that would lead to understanding how the various Aboriginal populations migrated across Canada. And that was the basis of his research. So Sapir studied Canada's Aboriginal languages. So that would be one example of historical linguistics. And another subfield of linguistic anthropology is structural linguistics.
Writing is a system of permanent marks designed to record an utterance in such a way that the exact form of the utterance can be recovered without the assistance of the utterer.
One estimate says that if language had existed for 24 hours, then writing wouldn't have come along until after 11 o'clock p.m.
Written language doesn't have much effect on spoken language, partly because most people have never been literate.
The Chinese writing system is one of the oldest writing systems on this planet. It is the only ancient writing system that is still in use today. It has had a continuous history. It has never been broken.
Local varieties of writing arose all over India. By the beginning of the current era, you start having Sanskrit written down. Previously, it was sacred, and it would be most unusual to write in Sanskrit. The local languages of India began to develop. The local inscriptions grew more and more different until by the present day in modern India, there are almost a dozen different official writing systems.
Allow me to introduce myself, because I am the dumb poetic entertainer. I am, yes, I am. I am multimedia forms, delivering forms. I am images, movements, sounds, sounds upon sound.
One good explanation for why structures of creoles are so different when we compare them with features of the standard varieties of the European languages is that the Africans on those plantations were exposed to non-standard varieties of European languages.
Okay, so what exactly is structural linguistics? In general, what structural linguistics is it studies how sounds are put together to make meaning. And Noam Chomsky, you see his photograph on the right there, he is known as the father of modern structural linguistics. And the reason is he came up with a theory known as universal grammar. And what universal grammar is, he stated that all world languages have a similar structure, which is called universal grammar. And what that means then is that all children are born with the innate ability to acquire language. That's the the basis of his theory of universal grammar. That doesn't mean that everyone agrees with him, and in fact, evolutionary biologists don't agree with him. So the theory of universal grammar is criticized by evolutionary biologists. And this is because evolutionary biologists believe that language is a learned skill, not an innate skill. Okay, one other thing that structural linguists look at is dialects and slang. And one of the things that they want to know is, why do we have something like slang? And in general, they've come up with three main purposes for slang. So in general, they say that slang, the purpose of slang, it serves three main purposes in a culture. The first one would be that slang is a type of shorthand that saves time. We don't have to speak in long, complicated, complete sentences with proper grammar. We can save a lot of time by using a shorthand like slang. The second reason, second purpose they think slang serves is that it is a more precise reference to observations within a group. In other words, within a group that all understand the same slang, we can be more precise with our observations. We don't have to use, again, long, grammatically correct explanations within the group to make reference to an observation. We can be very precise with one or two slang words. And the third purpose that they think that slang serves is that it reinforces and maintains group solidarity. In other words, everyone in a particular group of friends, a gang or something, you all use a particular slang that only your group or your members of your group understand, and then that reinforces the importance and maintains your group. You feel special because you understand your group's slang. Okay, so that is the second subfield of linguistic anthropology. And the third field is known as sociolinguistics, and this has to do with language and culture. So what do sociolinguists look at? Firstly, they look at how language and culture are related. That's a very important part of sociolinguistics. And they also look at how language is used to express status and context. In other words, what is your status within a society and what is the context of that status? There are many cultures where the kind of language you use helps to establish the status that you have in society. Are you looked upon with respect, or are you looked down upon based on your language? And so we can take a look at an example here. So, as an example, think of a southern accent in the United States. To, let's say, people in the northern part of the United States, they might look at someone who speaks this way as a hillbilly. In other words, a stereotype, simply based on their accent, not their level of education and their status in society. Simply because of the accent that they have, they might be looked down upon. And that might be something that happens in other parts of the United States. But that same person, that same Southern American person, their accent might be viewed as wonderfully exotic in Europe. So instead of having a stereotypically negative view of that person because of their accent, they might be looked upon as something wonderful, wonderfully exotic, because that accent is very different. So that is an example of what sociolinguistics looks at in terms of how it expresses status in society. And the third thing that sociolinguists look at is body language.
Look at me, I got a kiss.
So, examples of how body language is viewed in different cultures. So, here's one example. In some cultures, it might be disrespectful to look at a superior in the eyes. For example, it might be disrespectful for students to look at their teachers in the eyes when the teachers are talking to them. And one culture where that's true is First Nations cultures. Another example is it might be rude to show your teeth, because it displays too much aggression. So a culture in which that is true is in Japan. And so even when they are smiling, they cover their mouths. To hide their teeth. So that those are a couple of examples of how body language is related to culture. Okay, so that is the end of our basic introductory look at linguistic anthropology. At this point, it would be good to stop and do a class activity based on what we have learned so far in terms of linguistic anthropology.
Like this is your one chance to just dance, yeah. Come on, let the beat put you in the trance and just dance. South Dakota to the south of France. Yeah, see, I wanna rock right now. Stepped up in the spot to get down. I am internationally known for acting classy, trashy, and grown. Let's get stupid, outrageous. You can't fake this, it's contagious. Just move it, don't stay stiff. It's a rhythm that you can't play with. It's the groove that I selected. It's infectious, all you affected need to get on the flow and sweat.
So, that's the end of the first half of this lesson, which looks at linguistic anthropology. The second half is archaeology, and so our third question is, what exactly is archaeology?
Thank you. Look what we found.
What an amazing find.
It really is fantastic.
The biggest archaeological find of the century.
Yes, indeed. Gentlemen, from this single part and months of painstaking research, we've been able to accurately reconstruct this entire piece.
Okay, so let's begin by defining exactly what the field of archaeology is. So, it is a field of study to understand human past through the examination and study of its remains. So how exactly do they do that? Well, they look at what is known as material culture. So what exactly does that mean? What is material culture? So in general, it is the relationship between artifacts and elements of the society or culture. So that asks the question then, what exactly are artifacts? So artifacts are objects or materials made or modified by hominins. So that's a new word, hominins. In general, the term hominin is what paleoanthropologists refer to as the group consisting of modern humans, extinct human species, and all of the immediate ancestors. And we'll look at that more closely later on, but that's generally what hominins are. So examples of artifacts can be tools, and tools can be made of stone or bone, as long as they have been modified. It can also be art, like cave paintings or structures that they have built that remain, or clothing that has been made or modified. That is the definition of artifacts, and artifacts constitute a very significant part of archaeology. So, why is archaeology a subfield of cultural anthropology? Because it seems very physical. Well, the reason, well, there's a couple of reasons, and we'll look at those. One reason is because it uses the application of archaeological methods to understand the origins and diversity of modern humans. And that's why it is a field of cultural anthropology. Also, it covers the entire archaeological record from the earliest hominins to to present day trash from our kitchen. So archaeologists just aren't digging up tools of hominins from the earliest of times, but archaeologists can also learn a great deal about culture by digging through the remains of modern day society, and our remains would be our trash. And also, the archaeological record reflects the behaviors, values, and beliefs of the individuals who created it. So that is another reason. Again, behaviors, values, and beliefs are part of culture, and that is something that cultural anthropologists look at. And so because the archaeological record can reflect those behaviors, values, and beliefs, that makes it part of cultural anthropology. So what are the goals of archaeologists? There are three general goals that we can write down here. So the first goal in general is to reconstruct cultural history. So what this does is this puts the archaeological record in chronological order. That's very important. So that's one goal. They reconstruct cultural history. The second goal is they want to reconstruct and describe ancient life ways. In other words, the way of life of the ancient peoples. They want to be able to describe it. And this helps to put the archaeological record into context. We have the record, we have it in chronological order, but we want to contextualize that record by helping to describe the ways of life of the ancient peoples. And the third thing, the third goal of archaeologists is to understand how and why past cultures change. Cultures are not static. Societies are not static. They are constantly changing, modernizing. And so one of the things that we can do as archaeologists is we can begin to understand how and why these past cultures changed. And we get that from the archaeological record. Okay, so there are, in general, two subfields of archaeology. So we're going to look at each of those in a little more detail. The first subfield of archaeology is prehistoric archaeology. What does this mean? Well, prehistoric archaeology means that it's the study of past cultures that existed before the invention of writing. In other words, prehistory. Ultimately, history is a record, a written record. That's all we have in terms of what we know about history. So If we're looking at a culture that pre-existed writing, we call that prehistory, prehistoric archaeology. And there are some examples that we can look at. For example, consider prehistoric Aboriginal cultures in North America. So what they have done is they have studied the spread of tobacco from Central America to Canada. About 800 CE. CE is the same meaning as AD, so about 800 AD, or 800 years after the birth of Christ. And why did they do this? What information does this study give archaeologists? So this teaches about ancient trade routes, and also about the contact between various peoples, and three, it teaches them about agricultural and other cultural practices. Of Aboriginals before European contact. All very important elements of studying these early prehistoric cultures. So simply by studying the spread of this plant of tobacco seeds all the way from Central America, from Mexico, all the way up to Canada, you learn a great deal about the cultures that existed at that time. So that's important. Okay. The other main subfield of archaeology is known as historical archaeology. So, what does that mean? If prehistoric is before the time of writing, then historical archaeology studies left a written record. Or written evidence. And why do they do this? The archaeological record can enhance the written record by describing the daily life of people who might not be included in the written record. So what exactly does that mean? Well, if you consider that history generally writes about famous people, about the kings and emperors and their lifestyles, you might not know from that history the general daily lives of the average person in that society. They wouldn't have been important enough to write about in the history books. History books also tend to write about big events like wars and things. And again, you wouldn't necessarily know about the basic daily life of the people in that culture. So what the archaeological record does is it finds out information about the daily life of people and uses that information to enhance the historical record that talks about the big important events and people in that culture. So, one famous example that we can talk about, or one famous culture that we can talk about, is the old world civilizations such as Egypt. So archaeologists have long studied old world civilizations such as Egypt. And much of what we know about Egypt is from the translation of the written record. And the written record, the writing system in ancient Egypt, is known as hieroglyphics, which is a particular writing system, a pictographic writing system. The problem was that until about 100 years ago, the archaeologists had no idea what the hieroglyphics said. They needed a way to figure out how to translate those hieroglyphics. This was a dead language, and there was no way to figure it out. And along came something very famous, which is the discovery of the Rosetta Stone in 1799. And this Rosetta Stone was the key to deciphering hieroglyphics. Let's take a look at a quick video that helps to explain this.
Egypt is mostly desert, but a single great river flows through it. And here, on the banks of the Nile, lies one of the oldest civilizations on Earth. The pyramids here go back almost 6,000 years, and the various monuments and walls are covered in ancient hieroglyphics. Egyptian hieroglyphics are, of course, one of the oldest writing systems on Earth. But for 2,000 years, their meaning was completely lost to us. All the history of the great pharaohs was unknown until, in 1799, the soldiers of Napoleon turned up a large black stone. Here's where things get a bit unclear. The British army arrived. Napoleon fled, but he left the Rosetta Stone behind. So what is the Rosetta Stone? On its face were inscriptions in three different languages. The top lines were in the undecipherable hieroglyphics. The middle lines were scrawled with the almost equally unreadable demotic. But at the bottom, in a script as plain as the nose on your face, was Greek. And the scholars could read it. Every bit of it. It took a further 23 years to fully translate the hieroglyphics, using the Greek as the encryption key. And now, the great wealth of ancient Egyptian history has been decoded. And all the details of the Old and Middle Kingdoms, the time of the Sphinx, can be read and understood once again.
Okay, so that is a brief introduction into the other subfield of archaeology known as historical archaeology. At this point, what we're going to do is a brief exercise that takes a look at the various subfields of archaeology, and that'll hopefully help you better understand this subfield. And that is the end of lesson 4.
Like this is your one chance to just dance, yeah. Come on, let the beat put you in the trance and just dance. South Dakota to the south of France, yeah. See, I wanna rock right now. Stepped up in the spot to get down. I am internationally known for acting classy, trashy, and grown. Let's get stupid, outrageous. You can't fake this, it's contagious. Just move it, don't stay stiff. It's a rhythm that you can't play with. It's the groove that I selected. It's infectious, all you affected need to get